Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining me today. If any of you caught me on Instagram about a half hour ago, you know that I'm doing some mail art tonight. This is an envelope I created earlier today, and I was like, you know what? I want to make this envelope all over again. And so that's what we're going to do together tonight. I'm going to make a card that's going to go in the envelope, and then I'm going to make a new one. So if you would like your address to be considered for mail art, please go down to the link in the video description that says submit your address for mail art and click on that link. Later in the live stream, I will be taking address, well, probably just one address, but only from those that are submitted since the beginning of the live stream. So those of you who are watching live, you're going to have a better chance of having your address chosen. And especially if you're here at the beginning for this lovely explanation, you'll know exactly what's going on. So I'm going to start. I'm obsessed with this paper. I used it in my live on Friday. So I'm going to be using this paper again. And just for a reminder, I'm sorry it's sold out everywhere, but this, seriously, it's so amazing. I love this paper. This is the Ink Drops Vivid 12 by 12 pad from Craft Consortium. And I've gone through and I've already picked a pattern for tonight. And I'm going to be using the same pattern for the envelope as on the card. So this is the paper I've chosen for the envelope. I thought this kind of blue and purple and red was just amazing. So this is the envelope. I'll come back to this later, but this is for the actual card. So because I want lots of real estate on my envelope today, I'm going to be creating a 5x7 card. So I have a pre-folded 5x7 card here, and this pattern paper is cut to 4x6. And you know what? I need to start a new adhesive. My adhesive kept, like my Tombow Extreme Runner kept acting up funny. And I'm like, you know what? I've had the same one for years. Maybe I should just get a new one instead of getting just a refill. So that is what I'm doing today. And I should have opened this before I got going here, but I totally spaced it. All right, there we go. Nice, fresh adhesive. Yes, this paper is gorgeous. Hey, Dana. Just saw Dana in the chat. She's so sweet. She texted me earlier today. She's like, I'm just checking in. How are you doing, girl? I had not responded yet. So, Dana, I'm responding. I'm doing good. I need to text you back. I will get there. Hold on. I'll get there. All right. So, this really is one of my most favorite adhesives. It is just so super strong. This is Tombow Extreme Adhesive. It's linked down below. I'm going to do all four sides and then just a couple in the middle. And then I'm going to put this directly in the center. Just like that. Oh, isn't that paper gorgeous? Okay, so my plan, I did a really quick card sketch over here, and I was trying to think out some ideas. We're going with this one right here. So I've got pattern paper, obviously. I had to cover the whole thing instead. But I'm going to have a large heart cut out of vellum, and then I'm going to run the heart through an embossing folder. So I have to do it in that order so that the embossing isn't flattened out, you know? Hey, Dana. She's like, LOL. Okay, so got some vellum cut down right here. I just need to pick a size of heart. I mean, I could do this really big heart. In fact, you know what? The die I'm going to be using today is this one right here. So maybe a larger one would be a good idea. I think I want to kind of hang off the edge, and I will be cutting the edge off. I like that, so it can kind of overlap the edge of the heart a little bit. So we're going to cut the vellum out of this heart. This is Simon's Nested Heart set, by the way. I'll just run that through my die cutting machine. The paper is linked below, unless Simon has restocked it. Unfortunately, it is sold out at the moment. But there are some other websites online that have it. You might just have to do a little bit of a Google search. Okay, so the embossing folder I'm going to use, which I have not ever used this particular thickness of embossing folder in my electronic die cutting machine, so this will be interesting. I'm going to put it through as if it's just replacing this plate. Seems like it might be a little thicker than the plate. Oh, no, it's probably about right. Okay, I think we're good. I think we'll be good. I'm just going to put it through just like this and hope I don't break my die cutting machine. That would make some good live internet content, though, wouldn't it? Okay. Well, it's sort of embossed. Not really. I think I'd have to run it through with a shim or two. So I'm going to get it lined up again on those hearts. I don't remember which side it was. I'm pretty sure it was this side. I'm just going to get it lined up as much as possible. If not, I can cut another vellum heart. Not a big deal. But I'm going to run it through, gosh, I'll just grab a couple sheets of cardstock and see if that does the trick. Just from the sound of it, it sounds like it's a little of a better impression this time. Let's see how that did. It did better, but I was definitely off. You know what? It still works, though. It's just not as impressed as I would have hoped. Okay, I have this little... Let's do a test run with my scrap here, right? We're just going to do a little test run. This is what you do when you don't quite know what sandwich to use for your die cutting machine. You just have to experiment. All right, I think I've got like 4 sheets of cardstock, maybe 5. Okay, I'm struggling a little more with this one, so this is probably the right thickness. Oh, yeah. Well, does it really look that much different than the other one I did? It really doesn't look that much different. Let's just use that one that I have already. It's like a little ghost of a little... I think my vellum's a little too thick. That's probably the issue. All right. Also, this embossing folder is retired. It's real sad. I don't know what to tell you. I wanted a heart embossing folder, and that's the only one I had. So I went with it. All right, more die cutting. Oh, hello. Stop. I accidentally hit the button. And I hit it again. Stop. What is it still? I've got a ghost die cutting machine. This is the Lots of Love die set from Reverse Confetti. And you know what? I looked this up because I was linking to it down on the supplies. And it is sold out too. I'm like, what the crap? Everything I want to use is sold out. So then I'm like, well, I'll use something different. So I found something else to use and then looked that up. It was sold out too. I'm like, what the crap? Everything's sold out. Okay, so I'm going to cut this portion out of black. In fact, they're both coming out of black now that I think about it. I'm going to paint one in gold because I want it to match the gold that I'll be using on the envelope. So I'm cutting both out of black cardstock. This is pitch black cardstock from Hero Arts. I'll just run this through. die cutting machine is possessed tonight. Okay. Oh, good. I was hoping it would stay in the paper. Do you see that? Versus lots of love. Before we assemble the card together, I'm just going to paint this. So I've got some Yuli watercolors. This is the color Oscar. Let me zoom in for you. Seriously, my battery in my remote has been dying for months, and I don't think about it when I'm not actually making a card. Okay. I'm going to put one drop of water in there. And get my paintbrush wet. And you're going to get the best results with pearlescent paints like this or mica paints when you really let the water soak into the paint. If I was going to start painting this right now, it would be kind of watery. Like, that's actually not that bad, but we want it even thicker than that. Okay, and I like that it's still in the paper because then I can just go like this. I might have a little bit of a black edge, but I'm not that concerned because it's going to be sitting on top of the black outer layer. I mostly just want to make sure everything's painted. A little more water on my brush because my paint was getting a little too dry to work with. I find that these paints look best over a dark surface, so that's why I am using black cardstock instead of just cutting it out of white. All right, I'm just gonna get that little section, making sure everything's nice and painted all the way to the edge everywhere. All right, and before it really dries, I'm just gonna try to pop it out a little bit. I can always paint the edges to make everything perfect, which I might end up doing. Because then it's going to look like really good gold cardstock. All right, it's kind of popped up a little bit. I'm just going to go ahead and let that dry. I'll hit that with my heat tool to speed it up. We're live. We can't just wait for it to dry. I have my heat tool on the low setting. That's dry enough to handle. And pop it out. All right, I'm also going to take my craft pick and get rid of these little interior pieces. It looks a little bit rustic with the black edge, but I don't particularly want the black edge. So I'm going to hold this with my tweezers and I'm going to paint the edge. This is similar to when you use a black marker and you just, you know, color the edges. All right, let's see this. Okay, so I'm gonna just paint around the edges, and I can even hit a little bit on top too, just to make sure everything looks good. Paint's not quite as thick as I would hoped, so I might have to paint over these areas again. In fact, let's just get this paint thicker. This is the color Oscar from Yuli Watercolors. And I'm just going around the outer edge kind of just painting the black cardstock so that it looks a little bit more seamless. I don't know if this will really show very much, but sometimes it's the little touches like this that help things look a little bit more refined. For those of you who are just joining us and missed the beginning of my live stream, I'm going to be creating some mail art after I finish my card to go along with the card. If you would like your address to be considered, please fill out the mail art form that's in the video description. It just says submit your address for mail art. I will only be looking at addresses that are submitted during this live stream. So if you've ever wanted a greater chance of an address, your address being chosen, this is your time. This, like, painting the edge technique would be really fun, like, on a black die cut that wasn't painted already, you know, like, just giving it a little bit of an antiqued look on the edges. Okay, so see how those edges are just looking a little bit more finished as opposed to the ones on this side that I haven't done yet? Painting that top edge there. The paint isn't very thick right now. The thicker your paint is, the more it's going to stick to your paper. So if it's kind of like watery and bubbling up and not really staying in place, let your paint thicken a little bit and then you'll be all good. Like I said, this step might end up being unnecessary, but we'll see. Okay, I think we'll leave it like that. Pretty good. Oh, I didn't get these holes up here. All right. Lori's asking about when she paints with gold over black, that the black is still showing through. That's exactly what's happening. Your paint is a little bit too watery. So let the paint pan kind of dry and thicken up just a little bit, and you'll get a better paint. All right, I'm going to hit this with my heat tool on the low setting. Just to speed up the drying process. You could definitely let this air dry. All right, I think that got everything. So you can see it's such a pretty gold color. I'm debating if I want to do some gold splatters on the card as well. I think that could look really pretty. All right, we're going to put the lots of love on that, and then it's just going to be on the heart. Oh, that's going to be so cute. All right, back to my tweezers so that I can put some adhesive on the back. I'm using some Honeybee Precision Tip Glue. And I like to kind of have it on the tweezers, but hold it down. That helps it from kind of bouncing around as you apply your adhesive. Okay. And then directly down onto this die cut. I'm going to have to hold it in place a little bit because as I painted it warped. So I have to hold it down while it dries. Once it's the glue is dry, it shouldn't be an issue. Oh, that little spot right there doesn't want to glue down. I'm going to put a couple little dots of glue right underneath. Hold that in place. It shouldn't take very long to dry. This glue, for giving you a little bit of wiggle time, it does dry, you know, pretty quickly. Okay. All right. Now I have to think about where I'm actually putting this on the card. Because it's going to be a really simple card. All right, I think I want it about right there. I'm going to use some foam tape. And just put two lines of foam tape on the back. All right, and now I can put adhesive directly on the vellum. And that will hold it onto the card. I'm going to use my Tombow Extreme Adhesive. And then all of my adhesive is hidden. Okay. Last thing to do is just cut off this edge of the heart. Want it to go past the card. I'm using a T-square ruler from My Sweet Petunia to cut through that vellum. Probably could have just used scissors now that I think about it. Okay, to finish off this card, it's looking a little unfinished. At this very moment. So I'm going to take my white gel pen. This is like my go-to. If it's looking unfinished, I'll just add like a white dash border around the outer edge and it just like pulls everything together. It's like my little tip for you. Donna's asking about my hand. My hand is so much better. It doesn't hurt at all. Last week it was a little excruciating, but once it calmed down, it was fine. I think it was just a large surface area. That's why it hurts so much. All right, so I'm just going around adding this dash line. And it's going to help pull everything together and look more finished. Right now it's looking pretty blank. I don't want to add much more because I think it would detract from the beautiful pattern paper. But now that I'm looking at it, maybe I want some gold hearts. Won't some just small gold hearts be cute? I'm gonna refrain. Don't do it, Christina. Don't do it. Okay. All right. So super simple card. And I'm going to clean up a little bit and then we're going to go on to the mail art. All right. For those of you who are just joining, make sure you head over to the submit your address for mail art link that's down below in the video description. I'm going to be doing some mail art here in a minute, and I'm going to pick an address from those that were submitted during the live stream. So, go grab that. So Jen over at Reverse Confetti also, she sent me the dies I was using today, and also sent me this cute stamp set from Reverse Confetti. Isn't that so cute? It's called Love Bugs. So adorable. There's coordinating dies. And then this little tag set that has hearts. So cute. Thought I'd just show you guys because I haven't had a chance to use them yet. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and start assembling the card and then we will pick an address. Okay. So when I make custom envelopes, oh, I got to zoom out so you guys can see what I'm doing. When I make custom envelopes, I use the 123 punch board from Ware Memory Keepers. This is an older version that you might be able to find it for sale in some places, but for the most part, the versions that are being sold now are like a cream color, but it's the same exact punch board. So on the inside of the punch board, on the inside of the cover, you're going to have this graph here that shows the measurements you need for when you make your envelope. So let me just come up here. You guys can see this. So up here under 5x7, it says that my paper should be 9 7/8. And then just remember this 4 1/8. We'll use that in a minute here. But for now, the paper is 9 7/8. So I've cut my pattern paper to 9 7/8. What I'm doing today for my mail art, you could definitely do with, you know, any other pattern paper that you have, like in your stash. I think it probably looks a little bit better for patterns that have like bigger areas like this, as opposed to something that has like a really tiny fussy pattern. So a larger pattern tends to work better, but you could definitely use it for whatever you want. And here's the other side. This is the even more simple, larger pattern. See, there's just between the edges that create the interest, there's just big, wide, open spaces. Whereas on this side, they're not as wide and open. Hopefully that makes sense. I've cut this to 9 7/8 by 9 7/8, just like the punch board told me to do. And now I'm going to come to the actual punching part. I'm gonna take my bone folder out. And I'm also gonna swing this score extension arm out. And this is the reason why I like the 123 punch board over the regular envelope punch board. The regular envelope punch board from Ware Memory Keepers, while amazing and that it does the same thing we're gonna do today, this one has this extension arm. So when you're making 5x7 or larger envelopes, you're gonna need this extension arm. So that's why I recommend this punch board over the regular punch board. So the measurement that was over here, remember that? It was 4 1/8. That's what you're gonna match up here. So 4 1/8, bringing my paper in and I'm gonna match this top corner with the measurement. So 4 1/8, and you're gonna do two things. You're gonna punch and you're gonna score. So I'm punching and then I'm gonna score starting from the bottom of these two lines. This paper isn't super, super thick, so I'm trying to be careful. I don't want to cut the paper. I just want to score it. And if you're worried about like, I can't feel the groove, I can't get it in there, practice a little bit. You'll be able to tell, like you'll get a better grasp on it once you practice a little bit. Okay, can you see that score line right there? So now what you're going to do is you're going to take this score line and it has this envelope score groove. You guys can read that. It's kind of small on screen. But you're just going to match up that score line with this opening on the far left of the punch. And sometimes if you have a good score line in there, you can kind of wiggle it in and you'll feel when the score line that you put in, you'll feel it fall into that groove. I don't have a very deep score line today because this paper is pretty thin. So I'm just going to try to look in the light and kind of line up my score line with this little nub here on the edge. So now I'm going to do my two steps again. I'm going to punch and I'm going to score. All right, so we've got two sides done now. So now we're going to come to this one and this might be too much information. I don't want to confuse you, but I'm going to line up this score line with this edge right here. As I line it up, take note, it's back at that 4 1/8. There are four sides. Every other side is going to have the same measurement up here on the scoreboard. So if you can't find where your your score line is or whatever, and you just want to like double check to make sure you have a good envelope, just remember that the third side will have that same measurement that we started with. So here was side one, side two is down here at the bottom, and now we're working on side three. Well, I guess it was actually the other way around, but you know what I mean. Got 4 1/8. So I'm gonna do my two steps again, punch and score. And I'm scoring from the bottom line once again. And if you ever are making an envelope and you're like, I don't remember what to do, all of these instructions, a little bit more succinct, are written on the scoreboard over there. All right, so now we're back to this measurement here, and I can kind of feel it falling into that groove. Punch and score. The envelope making process is actually fairly simple once you get going. Okay, so now I've got those four score lines. It's a little hard to see, but I'll go ahead and fold it so you guys can see it here in a minute. And additionally, if you want to round your corners, you can put right here, the corner rounders on this side. You see that written on there? Corner rounder right there. You can round it right there, or you can do some of the other things for the boxes on the other side. Okay, I'm gonna put my bone folder back in there, and I'm gonna fold up these sides. Oh, I love that blue corner. So I'm just getting the sides folded up, and I'm gonna go ahead and actually assemble the envelope before we get to the address, because that's just the easiest way to do it. Okay, which one do I want my top flap to be? I think I want this one. So my envelope will look like this. It's gonna be so pretty. For adhering your envelope closed, you need a really strong adhesive. I like to use like a score tape. Sometimes score tape isn't quite even strong enough. So I'll use Express-It tape. And you can actually reinforce it with a little bit of glue if you want to as well. All right, something to note on these envelopes, specifically on the 5x7 envelope, and I think it happens when you do the A2 envelope as well, but I haven't done one in a while. When you fold up this bottom flap, see how it overlaps the side flaps? So we don't want to put any adhesive on this area when we adhere it together. So what I do, I've done this a lot so I can eyeball it, but I bring the tape up to about right there and then I stop. And I also don't take it all the way to the edge. And the reason why I don't take it all the way out to that edge or that corner is because, and this is something to note for when you close the envelope, if you don't leave a little bit of an opening, your recipient's not gonna be able to open your envelope, and they're gonna have to tear it open. So as long as you leave like a little bit of an opening, they can slide a letter opener or a knife or some scissors underneath to open your envelope. I don't know how many envelopes I received when I was doing mail submissions, like card submissions. I used to do mail call here on my YouTube channel, and people would send me their cards that they had made, and I'd show them on video, and the envelope would be completely glued shut. And I'm like, how do I open it? Like there were no openings to get in to like open it. So I'd have to tear the envelope open. So this is just the way I do it. Someone just asked, why don't you just put the adhesive on the flaps? I don't like to do that because if you notice when it comes down, this bottom edge is quite a ways away from that right there. So if you only put adhesive right there, this is gonna be catching on things, I think. So, but you know, do whatever is comfortable for you, whatever works for you is going to be best. I'm just giving you my tips. Okay. And that's pretty close, you know? And then when we put this flap down, it'll be nice and tight. Okay, so here's our envelope. Before we get going on the address, I've got to pick out the actual address. All right. Oh, this remote's going to drive me crazy. Come on, honey. There we go. All right. I have to look at my phone for just a minute here. Sorry, I'm going to be off camera. Loading all the addresses. Okay. All right. You know what? I'm going to take, well, maybe we'll do it by random drawing. Okay. I've got to write down some numbers. Okay. Tonight's first submission, once the live stream started. Okay. Do a little math. Okay. I'm going to go to random.org and pick a number. Well, I have to get a number. Okay. We'll just do. Sorry, I'm having to do math here. I'm trying to figure this out. Okay. That's the one I want. Generate one random number between 4722 and 4876. Get numbers. All right. The winner is 4757, and that is. Judy Ann Walker in Ontario, Canada. All right, let me write down her address. Now, everyone who submitted an address gave me permission to possibly use their name and address on this envelope. So if anyone is new here and they're worried that I'm using someone's address and putting it on blast on the internet, don't worry. I have been given permission. Ontario, Canada, not Canada, California. Okay. All right. Hopefully Judy's still here. I haven't, let's see, I'm just scroll up on the chat. Have I seen Judy come through here? Okay, anyway. So, Judy Ann, all one word. That's really pretty. Okay, so if you missed it at the beginning, this is the envelope I'm recreating. This is Monica submitted her address earlier in the month. So, she's going to be getting an envelope in the mail too. And you guys, like, confession, I have envelopes that I've had done for like 6, 7, 8 months that I haven't mailed out. So yeah, I'll be mailing some out soon. Okay. So the way that I discovered it was the easiest way to do this was to go ahead and write their name and then just paint over the top. Hold on. I'm going to put that down so I can get a better idea of what I'm working with here. Okay. And I'm also using this pigment deco brush because the gold paint looks great on top of it. You know, I was talking about how like this gold paint looks better on a dark surface. That's why I'm using a black pen. Oh, yay, Jay Walker, I'm here. Awesome. Okay, so I'm just trying to get an idea how I want to write her name. This is a very soft brush. I wish it had a little more bounce to it, but I think I've used it a lot. Think I have an idea of what I'm going to Okay. I'm just going to go for it. Kind of going off the end there. Walker. Let's see, how do I want to do this? I might not do her last name. No, I'm gonna do it. Okay, there we go. Right, I can still see a couple little wet spots, so I'm gonna go ahead and dry this just using the low heat setting on my heat gun. All right, and now we paint. And this is going to take a really long time because Judy Ann is a very long name. Much longer than the Monica I did earlier today. Have to laugh. Sylvie in the comments. Wait, are those real addresses? My true crime junkie self is silently screaming, no, if those are real addresses. You know what? Sylvia, I hate to tell you this, but your address is on the internet. You can find just about anyone's home address if you look hard enough. And I know that's scary to hear. I've just had to like just embrace it, just, you know, whatever. The internet is one big white pages. One big phone book. You can find anyone's address. Okay. So I'm just going to come in and start painting right over the top. And this is when, you know, you can really fix any areas that you might not like from the original lettering. Or you could put your envelope through a printer. Like do a test run. Print something and then see if whatever paint you're going to use over the top, make sure it actually looks good on top of the ink from your printer. And it's not going to like smear it or smudge it or bleed or anything like that. But all you do is trace over the top. And when you use like a thicker paint like this, like a pearlescent or mica paint, or even like a gouache, it'll go right over the darker paper. So, I am training for a race in April. That's a 10-mile race. It's not a 5K or a 10K. I did a 10K back in November of 2019. And so I'm like, I don't know if I'm ready for a half marathon. A 10-miler is just shy of half marathon. It's like something like 2 mile or 3 miles less, I guess. And so I'm training for this race, and one of my good friends, she's not like a super crazy runner, but she does like to do Disney races. And so back in December, she was doing like a 30-day running challenge. I didn't do it, but I saw her doing it, and she was doing pre and post-run stretching using Peloton classes. And I was like, huh. And she really credited it for helping her get back to running after an injury. So I was like, you know what? If I'm gonna really do my best on this race, I should probably get a really good stretching routine down. So I ended up signing up for the Peloton app, which is like $12.99 a month. Super reasonably priced, unlike their bikes. And and the next thing you know, I'm obsessed with like, I think I want a bike. I think I want a Peloton bike. So guess who bought one on Facebook Marketplace? Yeah. I found one on Facebook Marketplace, and it was like less than an hour between messaging the lady who was selling it and going to her house to pick it up. Actually, it was back at my house within an hour. It was crazy. So, oh, I put a little too much water in my paint. I'm gonna have to let it sit here and thicken up. So, I'm trying to pace myself, but those classes are so fun. I'm really trying to pace myself because, like, I have to run and train on my treadmill for this race, but then I also want to just bike, right? So, but you know what? I'm really glad that I tried the app for like about a month before I was like, maybe I kind of want the bike. Yeah, because then I really knew I'm going to use it. Like, even if I'm not cycling all the time, I know that I will use the app and the classes and stuff like for stretching and things like that. And then this whole world opened up to me. There are so many crafters that are on Peloton. My people that I know from my art retreat that I go to or used to go to every 6 months. Yeah. So any of you, if any of you are on Peloton and you want to join my little, I don't know what they're, it's the hashtag, I don't know, a group, anyone can. It is, instead of hardcore rider or bikers, it's cardcore. Cardcore bikers. So come join us. I'm not very good at it right now, but you know, we all start somewhere. So Dana says that her husband uses his bike with the app. He doesn't have the Peloton bike and it still works. Absolutely. In fact, before I got the bike, I was taking the biking classes but using my elliptical. And it worked great. That's how I kind of knew that, like, okay, I think I probably would like the bike. Because, I mean, of course, it's different than elliptical, but I was like, I've tried the classes. I really like the motivation. I think this might be something I want to try. And I looked into getting like a regular, like a non-Peloton bike. And I almost did, but then I decided that I wanted the added metrics and the stats. I'm a little bit of a numbers nerd that way. So I ended up just stalking Facebook Marketplace. They go so fast. If someone's selling their Peloton, especially if it's a really screaming good deal, which mine was. It goes so fast. The lady who posted it 6 minutes before I messaged her. So I really lucked out. I want to look at the chat, but I have to paint. Okay. Ooh, rowing. Hey, Sophie. She's down there crying. Come here, Soph. So I'm basically just tracing over the black lettering that I did. And even if there's little edges of black showing, it's totally okay because I'm actually going to go back over and add a black border, just like I did here. It just makes the name really stand out. Hey, Soph. She has, like, even if I clip her nails or her claws, she just has really tiny feet. And so they click on the floor. It sounds like she's wearing high heels. All right, we're getting close here. This gold shade is so pretty. If you didn't catch it earlier, this is the color Oscar from Yuli Watercolors. It's linked down below in the supplies. It is a really good gold. If you're looking for a good gold shade to add to your stash, I would suggest Oscar or I think it's just Christmas gold or Xmas gold, if that might be how she has it in her shop. But I love both. This one has a very gold metallic look to it, whereas the Christmas one has a little bit of shimmer. So they both have a similar gold tone, but the finish is just slightly different. Okay. I'm gonna get her last name really fast. Once I have the painting done, it actually goes really quickly. Except for picking out postage. With that, I can spend 10 years, but I might just pick out the same stamps for this envelope that I did for my other one earlier today. Because those stamps looked really good. Or I could lean into the Valentine's Day. In fact, maybe I will. Maybe I'll lean into the Valentine's Day and use like heart stamps or something. Julie was asking about why you would put the black down first. Well, for one thing, it gives me something to trace. So that's one reason. Another reason is because I think these paints look best on top of a dark surface. So let me see if I could go grab. It might actually not make a difference on this pattern paper because it's fairly mid-toned. It's not like bright white or anything. But yeah, having it as already written on there with a black marker makes it lots easier to paint, especially if you want like a really smooth edge to all of your letters. I know some lettering artists will use a pencil and draw on their letters first, even drawing on the thicks and thins, which is amazing. I find it easier just to go ahead and use a black pen. You could also use like a gray marker or something like that if you wanted it to be more hidden and not show as much, but I plan to add a black border to the letters anyway, so I'm not too concerned with that at this point. I wish I could have planned this area a little bit better so it wasn't intersecting the Y as much, but oh well. Kathy in the comments says that her coworker does a morning and evening ride. I could see that for sure. I think with my running, I think I'm going to try to run in the morning and then do like a really gentle cool down ride on the Peloton at night. Although today I am taking a much needed rest day. I wish I wasn't. I really want to get on the bike. But one of my knees is kind of bugging me today. So I'm like, I'm just going to take it easy. It's not painful and I'm fine otherwise. It's just when I'm working out that it starts to get a little twingy and I don't want it to become anything. So I think I was excited with the bike and I was excited with, you know, the training for the 10-mile race. And so I was like, okay, you're getting a little ahead of yourself. Pace yourself. So, like, cool your jets, Christina. Okay. I've got quite a bit of, like, black hanging out on this one side. But that's okay. I thought when I drew the letters on, it was a little blobby. So, I thinned it out when I painted it in the gold. I'm going to use the low setting on my heat tool to dry this. Actually, no, I'm not, because I noticed it changed the finish of the gold a little bit in some spots earlier. But you know what? I'm going to touch this one up. I didn't have a chance to seal it. And part of it just like flaked off a minute ago, and I'm pretty sure if I had sealed it, it wouldn't have flaked off. And it's hitting those little spots. Okay, and I'll set that one to dry, and then I will seal both of them at the same time. Maybe I will use my heat tool. I'm on live. I gotta keep going. Okay, so now I'm going to take a Marvy LaPlume pen. I've done this with a Tombow marker as well. I think any kind of water-based marker would work for this, but I've noticed that when you go over the edges of the lettering, it looks almost like it's going to put black over the gold, but then it's almost like the gold resists it and repels it. So, I mean, I'm being careful, but I'm not being like super, super careful as I go around. And I'm kind of like pressing down on the marker so that I get a thicker line. And then on the interior areas, I can just kind of scribble inside. I'm just going around everything and adding a black border. Now, if you didn't want to add a black border, you definitely could, omit this step. But I find that it really helps the name stand out. Okay, now I gotta start being careful because this is the actual part that will be on the end. Sorry for being so quiet. I'm trying to concentrate. I love like fussy work like this, though. Earlier today, I was listening to a podcast while I did this. Okay, so now I just gotta fill in all the interior areas. Just smoothing out that top line there. I have to laugh. Someone in the comments, I think it was Vicky or something, said that all this talk about exercise just makes her tired. You know what? I was not an exercise person until about 2017 when I started going to water aerobics with my sister-in-law and just fell in love with it. I found something that was fun, that didn't feel like work, didn't feel like exercise. And then, like no other time in my life, had I been familiar with the feeling of working out and that kind of like endorphin rush at the end, you know, when you've done something hard and you've accomplished it. I never really felt that because I'd never been, you know, a big exercise person. And all my experience of exercise was, you know, being in school and having to run the mile and about dying because I was so bad at it, you know. And it was just all bad experiences. I had not had any good experiences. So if any of you are exercise adverse like I was, don't give up on trying to find something that's fun for you. You know, some people really love walking outside because they can see things and, you know, things like that, walking with a friend. Find something that's fun for you. Okay, I'm going to do an address just like I did for the other envelope soon. It was like line of text right here. Let's see, is that going to be long enough? I don't think it will be. I think I need to come a little longer. I can fill all this in. And then just a little bit shorter for the second line. Okay. I'm gonna hit that with my heat tool just to make sure that all that black pen is dry. And I'm also going to, there are just a couple little spots where the black marker kind of overtook the gold a little bit. So I'm going to try to come in and just smooth out those lines. Like right there, right there. Right there. Okay. No more gold. We come to my white gel pen and work on the street address. You know what? And I'm going to double check on the spreadsheet here. Okay. I'm using a size 10 jelly roll pen. It's the bold version. That finished just about perfectly with the space that I allotted myself. too much space on the second line. That's okay. You know what we do? We add a little black to this end here. And add a little on that end also. And then ta-da! It looks slightly more intentional. All right, I'm gonna do my return address on the back. This is for my P.O. box, not my home address. Okay. Okay. The last thing I did before I did postage was I wanted to add a little bit of a gray shadow. So I'm using the Mild Liner Brush Pens from Zebra. This nice gray shade is super, super light, so it makes it really subtle. So, for example, on this one, the shadow is really subtle. It's not really, really dark. You can see it a little bit more on this end as well. So I just kind of add it in wherever I think there would be a shadow. And I like to go over it a few times so that it's a little bit more visible. And that just gives it a little bit of a shadow. It's more obvious on the address part. The return address, I should say. There we go. All right, let's pick some postage stamps and wrap this up. Okay, so I've got my postage books over here. And it has similar coloring to the one I did earlier today. So I could probably use the same stamps. I really like these three together, but I might change the Forever Stamp for these. Oh yeah, I was thinking of doing all the hearts. I might do that instead. Especially because it definitely is like the right tone. Like this one would be really cute, I think. Oh, that would be adorable. We're putting a Valentine's Day card in it. Why not? And then And then those other three. That'd be adorable. Looking through to see if there's any other ones that might be fun. This one might be fun. Let me grab it. No, I don't like it. It would have worked over here because it has the right tones for it. Maybe I'll add that one. No, I won't. Just seeing if there's any other stamps that I think would look awesome. This could look kind of cool. I like that. All right, and then let's grab those other ones because that tone of red and purple is really cool. Okay. Purple. I love this Edgar Allan Poe stamp because it's like this like purpley magenta. It's just so cool looking. And then that's one of my favorites. I think I've got 8 or 9 of those. There was just like this purple ink they used to use. It's this same one right here. Who's this? Oh, George Washington Carver. Yeah, but it's like that kind of like purpley. Like that would be really pretty too, but I won't put two of the same. We'll grab a red. Actually, since we're going for really fun here, how fun would this be? Oh, I love that. Okay, do I want to add another one? No, I think I'm going to leave it there. That's plenty of postage. That's overkill. Especially with the Elvis stamp that's like 30 or 29 more cents, I should say. For those who are wondering about where you can get postage stamps, you can buy them online. Go to Etsy and search for unused vintage postage, and you'll have a bunch of sellers that can help you out. Okay, when I'm dealing with these old stamps, I've discovered the best thing to do is paper towel or a sponge and just like spray bottle into it, and then press the stamp into the wet area, and that adds just enough moisture. Sometimes the edges need a little bit more moisture, so I might have to go around with a little paintbrush, but for the most part, it gets all of them. Make sure you get the corners. I love that Elvis one. It's so fun. This one's a regular sticker, like the Forever stamps that we're used to. And then I'm going to spray my paper towel a little bit more. And come on, Edgar. Here we go. You can see how old it is because it leaves like a yellow mark on the paper towel. Like, that's why you don't lick it. Okay, this one's peeling up. That's when you use a glue stick. Sometimes they just don't want to work. Okay, there we go. All right, Elvis, no more moving. Okay, so because I used a watercolor on these, your best bet is to seal it with some distress microglaze. Let me grab some. Got some over here. Distress microglaze sort of just puts like a really thin coating over wherever you apply it. But it also makes it really slick. So, you know how when the postage goes, when the your mail goes through the post office, they have machines that will like print like a little thing at the bottom, a little barcode. Some people would be like, I don't want it to ruin my envelope, but I don't mind it because I think it's more authentic and it shows that it's gone through the post. So part of that is when they cancel your stamps, like they stamp over the stamps so you can't use them again. And they can't do that if you put the glaze over the postage. So I like to use a mini round blending tool for this because it fits right inside the jar. Just dip it in there. Hold on, I forgot. I like to put down a paper towel because we're going to go off the edges here. Okay, I'm going to put this one aside and we'll work on this one first. And I'm just going to start applying it in circles. And I'm going right over everything. The first time I used this, I was concerned. I'm like, is that going to like rub off any of my design? And it doesn't. Okay, can you see that there's a little bit of a sheen on the paper now? That's the Distress Microglaze. Now, you're going to have a sheen on your paper probably for about a day. It takes some time to dry, but eventually it just soaks into the paper, and that's when it's going to be resistant to moisture and it's going to protect everything underneath. Okay, so I have covered everything except the postage stamps, and that also gives you somewhere to put your fingers to hold it down. So I'm just going to go over my return address, go off that edge, and then I'm going to grab another bit of paper towel. What you do is you just ball up your paper towel and you just buff that in. And it just takes away any of the excess so it'll dry a little bit faster. You do get a little bit of ink coming off with it, but it doesn't smear or smudge anything, I promise. Your project will be safe. And you can do this on anything. It doesn't have to be mail art. It can be a card that you want to protect a little bit more than normal. All right, so you can see there's just a little bit of a sheen to it now. And this will dry back perfectly. All right. Onto my other, actually, you know what? I'm going to get a new piece of paper towel. Because sometimes if you have a distress glaze, microglaze on the paper towel, and then you put something on top of it, like it would show up in spots on the back here. It's not a huge deal, but I've had it happen before. Okay. Getting some more distress microglaze. Do the same thing. I'm going to start over on this edge and just start applying it. Unfortunately, I did not think ahead and link the microglaze down below, but I'll add that when I'm done with the live stream here. Or you can just click over on any of my links over to Simon and then use their search bar and just look for microglaze and it should pop right up. Got one little spot that the gold flaked off. I was just rubbing a little too hard. Not a huge deal. Okay. Grab a bit of paper towel again. And start buffing all of this off. All Okay. Here we are. Not bad for an hour and a half. I'm gonna put these side by side. And here's the card we made to go inside of it earlier. Looks very similar. So those are the projects for today's live stream. I hope you guys enjoyed. I'm going to give a real quick spiel for those who are watching the edited replay, and then I'll stick around for a few minutes to answer questions. So those are the envelopes and the card for today. I hope you guys enjoyed this whole entire process. I think these are so fun. I love everything from beginning to end, from making the card to addressing the envelope and putting on the postage. And a big thank you to Monica and Judy and for allowing me to use your addresses on my envelopes. Thanks so much for watching. I'll be back very soon with another video. Until then, thank you so much for watching. All right, question time. And I'm gonna have to like scroll up a lot. Yes, some were asking about the paper. It's Craft Consortium Ink Drops Vivid. I link down below in the show more area to all of the Ink Drops papers that are available at Simon. I think most of them are sold out right now, but go ahead and do a Google search for like Craft Consortium Ink Drops, and you'll probably find a few stores online that have them in stock. Let's see. Looking for any other questions. Oh, how sweet! I was lucky enough to get one of Christina's cards and it was so cool to receive. I have it framed in my office. Oh, that's so sweet. I love to hear when they arrive, you know? 42 Rosie Rosie. I do not need this paper. I do not need this paper. I do. Hey, Christina, where's this paper from? It's funny. Andrea, considering Elvis was known for his wiggling hips, no wonder the stamp wiggled. I had the same thought. Oh, here we go. Elvis has left the building. Yep. The 15. Oh, yeah. You know, oh my word, you're so right. It does. Look at that. That's hilarious. It's actually Oliver Wendell Holmes. But you are so right. It does look like Sam Elliott. That's hilarious. Yes. Andrew says, I remember when you used a water brush for the stamps. You know, I did for a long time, and then I lost that particular water brush, and I didn't want to start a new one because you have to have a dedicated one for these postage stamps because the brush tips get a little gummy with the adhesive on the stamps. So, yeah. I thought she tore the stamp. That reminds me of the video I posted last week where I was taking a stamp off a sheet and it tore the stamp in half. What video was that? That was a week ago Monday. The one that has the big red heart on it, and then it says love, and then Happy Valentine's Day. No, it doesn't say love. It just says a big hat. There's happy really big. It was the happy stamp that tore in half when I was pulling it off the sheet. But don't you worry, it worked out okay. Oh, also, for those of you who are asking about postage stamps, I kind of stalk USPS.com. I look there quite often looking for new stamps. There's a really pretty new love stamp that I'm going to be ordering here. It's been out for a bit, but I haven't placed an order in a while. I'll place an order maybe every other month or so and just get whatever new ones they have that I can see myself using. Oh yeah. She's is it Zenobia? Is that how you say your name? I'm not entirely sure. I'm glad to know the metallic paint looks better on black. I've only tried it on white. Black never occurred to me. Yeah, I think they really shine on black. They just come to life on black. So definitely try it. Pam says, how old are some of these stamps? Are they reprinted or vintage? They are all vintage. So when I bought these Elvis stamps, even though their value is only 29 cents as far as the United States Postal Service is concerned, when I bought them off somewhere off Etsy, I think they were probably about 50 cents a piece or more. So it is a little bit of a commitment. You're spending more on postage, but I think if you're going to be spending so much time decorating your envelope and making it special and things like that, go ahead and go the extra mile and get that special postage. I think it makes it look awesome. And for those of you who are looking for just some really colorful postage stamps, I will share with you my favorites. They were the first ones I bought, and I bought like 5 million of them because I was like, these are amazing. And I've used them and I've rebought them. This is one of them right here, this energy conservation one, because I just love the colors on it. Come on, focus, honey. There we go. I just love the colors on it, like the kind of pink magenta, the blue, and the orange, and the green. So that's one that I bought a lot. But the ones that I have the most of that are vintage that I bought, let me find the right spread here, is right here. I guess it's just these three. This umbrella, it all depends on zip code, which is very like, almost makes me think of like Schoolhouse Rock. And then the energy stamp. And I just loved pairing those three together on a very rainbow, colorful envelopes. So those are the ones that I bought more of. I'm getting them out of order. There we go. I also have quite a few of this one because I thought it was really, really fun. The 1974 Expo, Preserve the Environment. This is my album that is all love and rainbow. So I have all my Valentine's Day love ones in the front. And then it gets into the rainbow, but it also has all my Disney stamps. So I'm just gonna zoom out for a minute here. Some of you had asked for like a postage stamp video. I don't know if I'm gonna do a full one ever, but this is probably the closest you're gonna get to it. This happy birthday stamp came out multiple years with different values on them. So, yeah, look for those. Those are some good ones. Let's see. I'm trying to find other. Oh, this is one of my favorites. I had the whole set, but then this cat. I keep using the cat one. Those are the ones that are missing. Aren't they so cute? Here's all the Disney ones. I think I've shown this in a video before. All my Disney ones. I went overboard on my Ariels for awesome, for obvious reasons. I think one of my favorite stamps, it's not like it, I have to use a lot of them on the thing to make it worth it, but Walt Disney. Only 6 cents, but I love it. It has little characters for him. I think it's a small world. I also love this like Steamboat Willie Mickey. And that's it. All right. I saw a few more questions come in. Let's see. I've been watching some of your old videos, and you used to use a masking and sort of a pen style, but haven't seen you use it in your videos. Did you not like it after a while? I believe you're talking about the Molotov masking pen or Molotov masking pen. I did really like it, but it dried out so quickly and gummed up to the point where I wasn't able to use it. So after like repurchasing it a few times, it became too much of a hassle. I went through a phase of really liking it a lot and getting it to work, but then I guess I just moved on. Let's see here. Oh, the backing of the stamp. Yeah, it's the sticker paper. I was like, what does she mean by tearing the stamp? Okay. How do you get the ink to stay on? What ink are you referring to? Let me know. Looking for questions to answer. Oh, that's a good tip. Just FYI, I was able to get all my crafts consortium paper pads on Etsy at a time Simon was out, so check there. Yeah, check Etsy too. Oh my word, a Wizard of Oz stamp. I collect Wizard of Oz. You know what? Was there a Wizard of Oz stamp? I didn't even notice. Do I have a Wizard of Oz stamp? Now I have to go back and look. Oh, I do! Right here. With Dorothy. Sure do. I only have one of that one, so it'd have to be really special to use. Yes, of course I use the cat stamps. Oh, dude, Catherine, break them out. She says, when my dad passed, I got all of his stamps. They're in storage, and I never thought about using them. Break them out. Like, if you're not going to be like collecting them, like he probably preserved them and collected them, break them out and start using them. A bunch of my collection came from, I think I've had two subscribers or viewers send me envelopes. No, three people have sent me packages with postage stamps, either that they were collecting or that they inherited or found at estate sales, and they just pass them on because they're like, I want them to go somewhere where they're going to be used. So, yeah, break them out. I know some people really love to collect them. I think it's one of the most widespread hobbies that are out there. But I think this is amazing to like, use them as they were intended. I think it's awesome. Let's see here. There are some beautiful lighthouse stamps available. What kind of album is that? Look on Amazon, look for postage stamp album, and you'll see a bunch come up. These are all ones from Amazon. Oh yeah, Looney Tunes cartoon stamps. There was a Bugs Bunny set that came out. It was this last year, I think, or maybe 2020. I have those. Those are fun. I haven't used them yet. Oh, the Rainbow John Lennon stamps. I think I bought one sheet of those, and then I started using them, and I bought like two or three more sheets before they stopped selling them. They might still be selling them. I don't know. The other one that I used a ton of are the Sesame Street stamps. I rebought those over and over because each Muppet is like a specific color, like Elmo's yellow, Big Bird, or not yellow, red. Big Bird is yellow, Grover's blue. They're all like almost just all one color. So they're really great for putting it on a colorful card or envelope design where you just want one color. So, a lot of fun. I'm not sure how to answer this question. What handwriting book or online tutorials would you recommend for beginners? Just handwriting, not specifically lettering. I don't know. So sorry. If you're talking about lettering or calligraphy, I do know that Happy Ever Crafter has a free beginning calligraphy class. I think something like 25,000 people have taken it. Like, it's really popular. So Happy Ever Crafter, I think she's on YouTube and on Instagram. Let's see here. That's what I showed in the last step, the Distress Microglaze. That is what I put on top. Could you link your overhead lights? I don't know where they're from. The designer I used, she ordered them. I'm not sure. And then we just have cam lights. So sorry. Check out, I think it's lampsplus.com or something like that. They may have come from there, or maybe that was my old craft room. I can't remember. Hey, Daphne. She's freaking out down there. I need to know what snips you use to cut apart your dies. There's no name on them. I think they were from Beadalon, maybe. I'm not sure. They're beading wire cutters, though. I know that. Let's see. Oh, yay! A friend's grandfather collected stamps for years, and she is using them, and it's awesome. Yes, use them. If you're not going to, like, continue on with the collection, use them. All right, I'm almost cut up to the chat. This is random. You used to design the SU Australia catalog. That's pretty neat. Yeah, I worked on Australia and Canada. I was in the international division and then transferred to product design. So I think like the first two Australian catalogs were ones that I worked on. Are you naturally gifted as an artist, or have you had to work at it over the years? I always had, like, I love to draw and I love to do artsy things, even as a child. But I think just like in any other skill, you know, the more you do it and the more you hone that skill over the years, you get better at it. So if I, like, we were cleaning out our basement and I came across some old books from college. And it went, like, I saw old design projects and I was like, this was pretty good back then, but I could do better now, you know, like you just grow with it. How is it there isn't a lot of glare on your glass mat when you're filming? It's because I purposely had no overhead lights put directly above my work surface. That's why sometimes I get weird shadows because the lights are all like to the side and back of me and things like that. I don't have any completely overhead lights. Okay. How do you make your dash line so perfect? Mine look a mess and so crooked. Is there a trick? I've been doing it a long time. That's part of it. But also, as I'm doing them, I'm like over and over rechecking myself, making sure I'm the same distance from the edge. So as I'm drawing along the lines, I'm just constantly checking. If you're unable to keep it straight, go ahead and use a ruler and a pencil and just a very light line to give you a guideline. And then you can do your dash lines, let it dry completely, and then you can erase it. That's what I would recommend. All right. Today, Shirley, I used the size 10 jelly roll. It's been my favorite for probably 3 or 4 years now, above the Uniball. Uniball used to be my favorite, but the jelly roll, but only the size 10. It's the bold one. If you go to 8 or 5, which are the smaller ones, and I think 8 was the original one for many, many years, it skips. It doesn't work as well. There's something about a slightly larger line, thicker line, that just helps the ink flow out of the pen more. So that's the one that I've been using for quite some time. The size 10. Yeah. All right. Let's wrap this up so I can edit the live stream down for our friends who aren't able to watch the whole thing from beginning to end. Thanks so much for watching today. I'll be back as soon as possible. I'm not sure when. Things have just been kind of weird and off kilter around here lately. I mean, I made a card earlier today, or it was yesterday. Hold on, let me find the first version of it that I tore apart. Where did it go? I painted this. And now it's like a scratch on it, which is, I'm gonna have to redo it. I painted this and then I put it on a background. Where'd the background go? There it is. I painted 2 different possible backgrounds for it. I put it on this one. See, it was adhered there at one point. It was like that. And then I'm like, I don't like the purple. So I might recreate this and change it up. I also thought maybe I'll put it on top of that, but I'm like, that doesn't really match the style of the stamp. Anyway, I've got to figure it out. So I'm not sure when I'll be back with another card, but thanks for joining me tonight. This was really fun. I will hopefully have another card for you very soon. Thanks for joining, everyone. I'll see you guys next time.